Pero am I audible over the web? Windows 10 Home OS, get rid of it. Because the problem is, tomorrow for you, Docker cannot be installed on that operating system because Hyper-V is not supported there. So Windows 10 Home, I don't think so is the right thing to have. Okay, but I know for some of the people who might have brought the home laptops. So what you can do is take a Azure account for 1 month at least. You can go with Windows 10 Enterprise because you have $200 of credit. Home is not that great version, right? Yeah, I can understand. Okay, or at least completely switch to Linux. So in I'm not sure whether it is supported in Windows 10 Home or not, but there is something called a subsystem Linux in Windows now. So basically from Windows itself, you can launch Linux systems directly just by one command called as bash. You go to the command prompt and enter bash and the Linux kernel will start. You might miss on all of those features if you are on Home. Okay. So yesterday we have started writing some YAML files, right? And then the approach which we have followed is we have looked into manual or basic Linux commands, and then we are trying to convert everything into equivalent module. Yes, yeah. So this is an approach which will work for any tool. Today, yesterday, I've said that at least try installing LAMP server before coming to the class. Okay, yeah. So we will look into that and let us see what are all the commands. Let us make a list of it and let us see how do I write an equivalent Ansible YAML script for that. Right? Making sense? Right? So the practice or the approach which I'm discussing right now, please follow it religiously. Please follow it religiously because tomorrow, if your company says to do something, anything on a Linux machine, this is your first approach. You will make a list of each and every Linux command. You will execute it manually once so that you know what is happening. And then for every Linux command which you are executing, you will convert that into an equivalent YAML statement, equivalent YAML task, equivalent YAML module. That's the whole point. That's how Ansible works, right? Okay. So LAMP server on Ubuntu 16. Okay, let me make a note of all of the Linux commands first, and then we will find for each command, whatever it is, how to find the equivalent module. Because that is the easiest approach to work on Ansible. Right. So let me go to my E drive, SQL zone, Ansible zone. Basics, and in this, okay, I'll be opening this with Visual Studio Code. For writing playbooks, I'll be using the Visual Studio Code because it helps me, right? It helps me in formatting and all of that stuff, right? So July 2018, right? There is something called as classroom examples. I think this is the best place. Okay, we'll move it later. So in here, I'll be writing a file which is called as lamp.md document. That's it. Okay. So in this document, what I'll do is first I'll copy the URL so that we know what we are doing. Okay. Installation from. Have this habit. I'm showing in this classroom because I want you to do the same approach. All right. What is the first step? What is written over here? Okay. Fine. Let me make a list of all of these commands and then one by one we will convert it into an equivalent Ansible stuff. Right? Yeah, this we don't require because this is a test. We don't require it. Okay. And then there is some configuration file. Okay. If you want, you can change it. For us, it's okay. There is something called as restart Apache. Third, firewall, we don't require it. We are using AWS, and in AWS, we have our own firewall, which is called a security group. So we need not worry about this stuff. Okay. And then you access this web page. So good. Till here, it is fine. MySQL, I said, I'll be skipping this because I want to show MySQL in a different world because we'll be discussing something called as roles where this is very much simplified. So I'm not discussing on MySQL. Let me scroll down a bit. I have to install PHP. Okay. So here I have multiple packages. Till in the earlier case, I have only one package, which is Apache 2. Now, if you see, there are multiple stuffs like PHP, lib, Apache 2, and all of that. Okay. Good. And this is not required. Okay. Again, we have to. Restart Apache 2. Okay. Status is not required for us because we are running it through. Not so much. And then we have to create a file. We have to create a file. Create file at. Okay. And the contents of that file are. So this is our work on a whole. On this page, if I have to list out the Linux actions, these are all the stuff which I'll be doing on a machine. So for each and everything, let us try to see what is that we can do in Ansible. Right? So this step is clear, right? This is not a difficult stuff. You get a installation document, you make a list of all of the commands, you write it in a separate document. As simple as that. If you have executed this already, nothing like that. Because you know what every stuff does. So for example, for the people who have not done this, what is this meant for? Why do we do this update? Package update, all right? So this is installing Apache server. Okay. And then this is restart Apache service, right? And then install PHP modules. Okay. Again, restart Apache service. And then create a file, create a homepage. Simple? Yeah. These are all the steps. Now, let us try to think them in Ansible. To do this, we don't need much of intelligence. The only thing which you need to know is a location to the right documentation page. Yes, if I say that, can you install Nginx on Ubuntu 16.04? Can you make a list of these kind of steps? The only thing which you have to do is you have to Google asking installing Nginx on whatever operating system which you are trying to, right? Similarly, I've said Ubuntu 16. If I say Red Hat, then you will have different set of commands, but something like this, right? Yes or no? If I have to install Tomcat, will I get something like this? Right? Installing Python, will I get something like this? Deploying any application, will I get steps like this, manual steps? Yes? Okay. Now, when we are automating, let us assume I'm writing a shell script for this. So the only thing which I do in shell script is I'll make a list of all of these commands in one file and I'll call this file as sh. So I have to write a shell script for this. So let me quickly write a shell script for that. Okay. So so that you will understand what it is. So lamp.sh, the only thing which I'll be excluding from the shell script is file creation. Apart from that, if you see, what is the first command? Okay, and then so this, when you execute, if you execute it manually, it will ask for whenever you execute this, this will install the packages. Do you want to continue? Yes or no. And whenever you are executing shell script, you should not get that prompt. Idu nen command execute chesthe adu nannu question adugutundi. It will ask me a question. Do you want me to continue or not? In any automation, it should not ask for user prompts. Is this statement clear? Yes. If I execute any command, it should not ask me for any user prompt. So that's why I'll add something called as minus y. Whenever it asks for yes or no, take the answer as yes. Good. And now what is the third one? Restart. Okay. And then this. Okay. And here also you have to add minus y, because it will ask for yes or no. Yeah. And then again restart. And then you have to create a file. To create a file, you'll be writing touch, or you can do something like this, echo. Okay. It's okay. It is not exactly correct statement, but it's okay. Okay. This is what you are echoing, and you will echo this stuff to a file which is called as this is how you write shell scripts. Even for writing a shell script, knowing the list of commands is enough. If you have some conditional statements in this, you might have written if condition. If you have to iterate something, you might write a while loop, all of that. But this is a very basic shell script. Yes or no? Yes. Yeah. In the same way, I'll be following it for Ansible. I know the steps. I know the each and every Linux command. And for every Linux command, I'm going to find out an equivalent module. That's it. Okay, we will make this equation slightly complicated, okay, probably in the next coming days, by making this script work for both Ubuntu based machines and Red Hat based machines. If I have to do it on Red Hat also, it should basically work. That's the whole idea. But for now, let us stick to simplicity, and then let us add complexity to it. Okay, so is this clear now? We have shell file. You run this shell file, you'll get basically lamp stack installed on your machine. Done. Now the stuff which is left for us is writing a YAML file. So let me create over here. I'll be writing a new file, and this I'll be calling it as lamp.yaml file. Right? And yesterday we have realized that to start this, we will always use three hyphens, because when we use three hyphens, we can write multiple playbooks in the same file. Good. And the first one in here is host. Okay. And to which host do you want to apply? As of now, I'm not clear, so I'm writing all. So, and then I'll be writing, do I need to become a sudo user? So, become as simple. And then we'll have. What is the first task? Update packages and install. Do you agree to this? Okay. Now, Ansible modules. Yesterday we have looked into it, and we have found out that there is a package called as apt, which is enough for our case. So all modules. Let me search for this apt. Okay. So let me go through this table again. Okay. So these are all the values which I can give in the apt. So this is for sure that I have to use apt. Okay. And now go through this. How, where do I pass the package name? Where do I pass the package name? Can I use name? A list of package names. Okay. So this is child. So I'm giving two spaces. Name. And what was the package's name over here? Sudo apt-get install Apache 2. So this is the name of the package, right? Done. Yeah. And then I also have to basically update the caches. So I'll be using a property which is called as update cache. And the value of that would be. So with this statement, what is that I have automated? Did I automate these two steps? I've installed Apache and I have also updated the packages. Now I have to restart. I have to restart. Now, what is that restart command? It is restarting a service, right? Yes or no? Yeah. So let me go back. I'll come back to this page again, but let me see if there is something called as. You'll have a lot of services. This is a very huge list, so it might take time. Are you seeing services? Yeah. So let me go to the service. And now let me look at this. So here it is trying to tell that if you are using for Windows, then use win underscore service. But for all the Linux services, this is what I have for you. And in the service, what is that it has given? In service, there is something called as enabled. What is enabling in service? If you enable the service, what will happen? Next time when you restart the machine also, the service will be started. So we want this. Okay. And then what are the states? So what is the state which you are looking out for? We restarted. And how do you tell name of the service? We have something called as name. So can I write something like this now? Task. I'm explaining the task. I'm just trying to tell that this is restart Apache after installation. And then what is the module's name? Service. And in this service, I will have something called as name. And what is the name of the service? Okay. And then we have also looked at some of the properties, which is enabled. So enabled. Yes. And then state. Restart. Simple. Or is it looking difficult? Right. I have used first the package which is called module, which is called as apt. And now I have come back to the module, which is called as service. Now let me go to the third Linux step. What is it trying to tell? Apt-get install. So which is the package which I have to use again? Same one, right? Yes. Hyphen name. Install. PHP packages. And then the module which I'll be using is apt again. But the problem which I have is this time I have multiple stuffs. So let us see if I can solve that. So let me go back to this. Okay. Let me see if I can apt underscore. Yeah, good. Okay, let me get into examples. Okay. Fine. Any example over here, is it basically taking multiple packages or only one package? Multiple packages, right? So there is no way that I can pass multiple packages. So for that, one approach is write individual package as an app. So in the end, first write apt php and then write one more section which is libapache2-mod and then one more stuff which is php mcrypt and then php mysql. Yeah, it works, but the problem is that approach I somehow don't like. That approach I somehow don't like. So shall we find out if there is any other way? Shall we find out if there is another way? So what should happen now? I am writing only apt name and I want multiple packages to be installed. Multiple packages to be installed with one command. I don't want to write it multiple times. I don't want to write it multiple times. So if you look at examples, okay, he's using some strange behavior over here. Okay, so that is one way. Or there is one more way. To use something called as loops. So let me go with the standard loops. Are you able to understand what is that he has written it over there? Okay, so let me write it down. Okay, I will not worry about this name at now. So what is the other thing which we want? So I forgot one thing over here. Even though you don't write it, it is good you always write status. So let us not worry about the name right now. I am writing status present. But the problem which I have is I have multiple packages. Yes. So to tell multiple packages, I will be following this syntax where I'll be telling with underscore items. Okay. And what are the items? What are the items which we have? Every installation module which you have to. So PHP. And then what is the other item? Did you got the essence of it? This is like writing a for loop. Yeah. If you have to write a for loop in Ansible, you'll be writing something like this, where you'll be iterating the same thing again and again by writing, saying that I want whatever task which you have written, right, to be iterated with whatever items which you are seeing over here. Okay. Now, ఇది ఒకేసారి రాసుకుని ఎంటర్ కొట్టుకుంటే సుఖం. రైట్, ఫైన్, డన్. సో ఐఎమ్ ట్రైంగ్ టు టెల్ దట్ ఐ వాంట్ టు ఎగ్జిక్యూట్ ఆల్ దీస్ ఫోర్ ప్యాకేజెస్ అండ్ ఫర్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ దీస్ ఫోర్ ఐ వాంట్ ఐటరేట్ దట్ ఐటరేట్ ద టాస్క్ అండ్ నౌ వెన్ ఎవర్ యూఆర్ డూయింగ్ దట్ యూ హావ్ టు టెల్ ఓవర్ హియర్ వాట్ ఈస్ యువర్ ఐటమ్ అండ్ ఫర్ దిస్ యూ హ్యావ్ టు యూజ్ ఎ స్పెషల్ సింటాక్స్ విచ్ ఇస్ యూజ్ కర్లీ బ్రేసెస్ అండ్ యూజ్ double curly braces and within that try to write something called as item. So whenever it first executes, in that item will be replaced with php. Second time when it is running, it will be replaced with libapache2-mod-php. Third time when it is iterating, php mcrypt. That is a loop. Simple? Yes. This is a basic for loop ante. Since we are not writing a programming language here, to write a loop we'll be following the syntax. Okay, later on what we will do is with items we will be replacing with variables, but till now we have not defined any variables. We are hard coding the stuff. Okay, is that simple? Yes. Now let me look at one more stuff over here. Again, what I have to do? Restart Apache. So I have written it once already, but again I have to do it. So I'll be copying this again. Not at all a good practice, but it's okay when since we are trying it for the first time. Okay, restart Apache. After, you cannot have two same names, two tasks with same name. Make sense? Yeah. So let us try it out till here. Till here, was a difficult journey or a simple journey? Okay. It doesn't expect you to have any coding knowledge. The basic stuff what you are trying to do is you are trying to take a Linux command and trying to convert it into a module, right? And for doing that, you will be basically going through the documentation, reading through all of the table and just filling in the values and filling in the values. So is it looking good or bad? Or do we have any doubts on this? Let me look at questions before I proceed. Always we write Ansible script in YAML file. Yes, that's the only format that is supported, right? We can write in shell script also. Yes, you can write in shell script, but shell script, will it guarantee idempotency? But Ansible does. You run this script one time or thousands of time, every time you will get the same result. Yesterday we have witnessed that. Yesterday while I was doing apt-get update or whatever I was trying to do, it was giving me something like okay and changed. Change will tell me if it is doing something, and okay will tell me if the states are maintained. So that shell script might not give. Yeah. Okay. We want to store the Ansible data where we push. Not really. We'll be writing the YAML file, and pushing is taken care by the Python code that is being converted. So you and me need not worry about it. Yesterday I said, right, whatever YAML file which you are writing, you will give it to the Ansible, and Ansible will convert it into the Python script. It will log in into the other machine via SSH, and it will give that Python script to the Python that is present on the node, and that executes the script. That's how all of the stuff is working. So really we don't push data, we just push the same file. Okay. Do we need to follow the structure of no man? Nothing. YAML is required. I just written MD because MD is a format of documentation, markdown format, especially in the Git world that is very popular. Okay. And SH, since I was writing a shell script, YML because I am writing Ansible. That's it. Ansible playbook. Okay. You don't need anything. You just need YAML file. The only thing which you require is YAML file. But for me to come here, I had done three phases of it. So whenever you are learning, please do these three activities. One is documentation. The other one is shell script. The third one is YAML file. Because in your interview, you might be asked questions on shell script also. So that's how you'll come to know, learn the stuff. Okay. So now you are parallelly learning both shell script as well as YAML. Have a habit of doing that. Especially for the people who don't know how to write shell script, follow this practice. Linux కొత్తగా పరిచయమై ఉంటది కదా ఈ రెండు రోజుల్లోనే వాళ్ళు పరిచయాలు ఇలా పెంచుకోండి రైట్ ఫర్ ద పీపుల్ హూ హావ్ స్టార్టెడ్ లెర్నింగ్ Linux క్వైట్ రీసెంట్లీ ఫాలో దిస్ అప్రోచ్ బికాస్ యూ విల్ బి లెర్నింగ్ టూ థింగ్స్ ప్యారలలీ రైట్ వన్ ఇస్ యూఆర్ ఎగ్జిక్యూటింగ్ ఇట్ మాన్యువలీ దెన్ యూఆర్ రైటింగ్ ఎ షెల్ స్క్రిప్ట్ అండ్ దెన్ యూఆర్ రైటింగ్ ఆన్సిబుల్ సో దట్ ఎనీథింగ్ గివెన్ యూ కెన్ కన్వర్ట్ ఇన్ టు ఎనీ అదర్ ఫార్మాట్ దట్స్ ద హోల్ పాయింట్ ఓకే రీజనబుల్ యా ఐ హావ్ మిస్డ్ అవుట్ ఆన్ వన్ స్టెప్ దట్స్ ఓకే ఓకే ద ఇన్ఫో డాట్ పిహెచ్పి at the last I have not written it because I want to do it in a different way. I don't want to do it in this format, so currently I'm not doing that. But till first 5 points in here I have done it. Sixth point I'll be doing it after some time because we need to learn something called as templates. We'll be learning something called as templates, and that is the point when I want to introduce to you that concept. So sixth I am not doing it. So till 5 I am doing it, right? So is it clear? Yeah. So deentlo emana doubts unnaya? Okay, good. Now let me change my stuff. Installing, okay, Nginx on Ubuntu 16. Can we do this? Yes or no? So what is the approach which will follow? First I'll do it manually, and then I'll make a list of every Linux command which you are seeing, right? Every Linux command. And then we have something called as status done. So the only thing which we'll be doing over here is only this part. In the place of Apache 2, we'll be writing something called as Nginx. Okay. Now let me show you something else. Installing lamp stack on CentOS 7. So what is the stuff over here? What is the first command? Sudo yum update. Okay. So what will I do? First, I need to find out a module. So let me go over to all modules. Okay. And what should I search for? Am I seeing something? And in here, there is a table which tells you what has to be done. Right? Or since we know apt, you can directly also jump to examples. Are you seeing the first line there? Much like apt, right? The only thing that has changed is in the place of apt, we have something called as. That's it. Now, the first thing is yum install httpd. Now, systemctl start. Systemctl is service. Systemctl is service. So, this is nothing but a module which is service module. Service name httpd.service and then state is started. State is started and enabled if you want. Okay. Now you have to install MySQL. I'll be skipping it. And now I have to install PHP. And then if required any other PHP modules. And then the same info.php page. Right? So shall I write one more YAML file for CentOS? Yes. So before that, what I'll be doing is in this file. Okay. Oh boy. Okay, in the same file I'm writing for CentOS based systems. The first command, okay, sudo yum install httpd. Second command, systemctl sudo systemctl. Systemctl start httpd.service. You can write httpd also. So I'm writing just httpd. Okay. Third one, we have to install Apache the PHP packages. Sudo yum install. What was it? PHP iPhone. MySQL, right? And then the fourth one, sudo systemctl restart httpd. Fine. Okay, four steps. And the last step is creating the file, which I'm skipping anyway. So can I write an YAML for playbook for that? Yes. So shall we try it? Yeah. So let me go over here. And I'm creating a new file, which I'll call it as lamp for centos.yaml. Whatever I'm trying today is not professional approach. Because we generally don't write two YAMLs, one for CentOS and one for Ubuntu. We try to write everything in the same file. But it's okay. Today is our first YAML file. First little bit professional looking YAML file. So let us not think of optimizing it. So I'll do the same thing. This is because tomorrow if I want to add something to this file, I want to do that. And then hosts. As of now, I don't know the list, so I'm writing all. Am I using sudo? So become yes. Yes. And then left task. First task. Okay. Install httpd. For that, we are using a module called as yum. 1 minute. Man, this is too much. Okay. So there is help actually, but is making it too much difficult for us. Okay. So yum name is equal to httpd. State is equals to name. What is the second one? Restart the service. Okay. So restart or start httpd. Start httpd. Why? Because in CentOS machines, in Ubuntu based machines, whenever you install the Apache, the service will automatically be started. In the case of Red Hat machines, it will not be started automatically. You have to start it on your own. So that's why here you are saying service. The command doesn't change when it comes to service. Okay. Service name is httpd. Okay. Enabled. Yes. State. Started. And then name. Install PHP packages. Okay. And then it's not service, right? It's yum. How many packages do I have? 2. But generally this we use for 1. So I'll be using name, status, present, and then with underscore items. And what are the items? PHP and then PHP hyphen MySQL. To access this, what will I do? I'll use double quotes, double curly braces, and within that, okay, and then I have to restart the service. So name, okay, restart Apache. Okay, so service name httpd, state restart. Looking difficult? Pardon me? Update cache is not required because there is nothing called as yum update in this installation steps. If that was there, then I would have searched for it. Okay. Yeah. So is it looking good? Yeah. So that's the same approach. No matter you, the work you might be doing might be complicated, right? But any complicated step which you are doing during deployment will be series of multiple Linux commands. And for every Linux command, I'm converting it into a task. Okay. And in Ansible, the best part is you have a hell lot of modules. You have a hell lot of modules. So writing these tasks is really not difficult. The only thing which you'll come to know is, since we have written apt, this time I have not referred documentation, yes? But while I was writing apt, I had referred to the documentation because I didn't know how to write it. Slowly, when you start writing it, right, there is no need for you to go through the documentation. You will write it on your own. That just comes by experience. You cannot remember this stuff. Try to write 4 or 5 playbook files. The time taken to write a playbook file drastically reduces from the first to the fourth if you are understanding what you are trying to do. Simple? Yeah? Okay. So till this point, do we have any doubts before I execute this? That's it. You can give anything that makes sense to you. Name is your documentation. Why are you doing that step? So that is like a description. So description is your choice. You can write whatever that makes sense to you. 100 nodes same time or 1 to 100 sequence of execution. You can execute it parallelly also if you want. By default, Ansible executes 5 machines parallelly, if I'm not wrong. 5 or 10. I'll look into the documentation and tell you. That is called as forking. Right? Okay. How can we remember all of the steps? Is there any steps? Why are you trying to remember, first of all? I didn't try to remember anything. What was my approach? I've gone to the documentation, copied the individual steps into a documentation file, and then for every individual Linux step, I'm just trying to convert into a module. There is no need for remembering anything over here. Okay? There is no need for remembering anything over here. Okay? The only thing which you have to look out is, look into documentation, go to the examples, follow the same structure. Okay? Okay. Is variable name on item? Okay. So, this is not a variable name, by the way. This is an expression. This is an expression. And what this expression does is, it will try to get what is the current item in the with items which you are using. So, basically, when you execute with items, this part will be executed twice. This part will be executed twice. This is right, like writing a while loop or a for loop. So, during the current iteration, what is your value? When you iterate for the first time, the value would be PHP. When you iterate for the second time, the value would be PHP-MySQL. That's it. Good. Any other doubts in the room? Okay. Better? When we started Ansible from day one to now, is it looking good? Yes. Now we are understanding what we are trying to do. Yeah. Why we use? Name is just to describe documentation. Manam comments rastam kada. Enable. Okay. Service enabled. You are asking that. Okay. So generally when you write a service, right, it will be in a started state. But once you shut down the machine and restart the machine, service will not be started. Okay. When you are restarting the machine, if you want service to be started, that is called as enabling the service. Mee system start chestunnappude service start ayipovali. That is done when you enable the service. If you don't enable the service, every time you restart the machine, you have to go into that machine and start the service manually. So that is enabling. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Looking good? Yeah? Okay. So there are still some questions. What do the present state denotes? Is it present means current state or do it mean available? No. Present means in Ansible, what is it I'm trying to tell? Ansible and ippudu em cheptanu. What is that I'll tell to Ansible? What is that I want? What is that I want? Right? So I am telling to Ansible that I am interested in putting the Apache server to the state which is running. So this is something which you are telling to Ansible that I want this to happen. If this is already in that state, don't do anything. So state is always an input of what you want to be. So for example, when I say M state HTTPD present, that what do I mean by that statement is, I want HTTPD package to be present on the Linux machine. So I'm not telling it to install. I'm telling that I want it to be there. Now Ansible understands that since HTTPD is not present on that machine, and it will try to install it. Okay? Because if you remember during our first class, we said that if you are working in tools like Ansible or Chef, you will most of the time, you will not tell how to do the things. You will tell what do you want. You will tell what do you want. You are basically writing in that way. So this is not a functional programming or a procedural programming like shell script where you tell what has to be done. Here it is a declarative programming. You would tell what do you want. What do you want? And Ansible knows when you tell what do you want, how to do that. Right? So that's the stuff. So for example, if you have to create a file, you will be using a module called as file. And then you would be telling path of the file. And then you will tell state is equal to present. So what do you mean to say with that is, I want that file to be present at that location. How you create, I am least bothered about it. Okay. So in Ansible, that is the language which you use. You are always telling what do you want. So state tells what is that you want. If I replace present with absent there, it will uninstall HTTPD. it will uninstall HTTP. Okay, good. Host, don't worry about the host right now. I'm not worrying about host right now. So host gurinchi paddaga worry avadu. Okay, we will cover it when the time comes. Okay, so today what we have learned is with items, right? And if you have a Linux step, can we find out a module? Yes, yes or no? Yeah, okay, good. Now there is one step that is left, which is creating the file, which is creating the file. So shall we see if we can do anything with the respect to the file? There is something called as file. Let me go to the examples directly. So what is written over there? File, path, and then permissions. Okay, and then if you see, there will be something called as present or absent or whatever it is. Okay, now let us see the states. You have a state for file which is called as file, and then you have a state which is called as directory. So if you want to create makedir or touch, you'll be using the same thing. Okay, and then let us see what are the different things which are present over here. I'll not be using this today, but because I wanted to use it in a better way. Okay, so now let us assume that you want to copy a file from one place to other place. Okay, you want to use CP. So are you seeing something called as SRC source? Okay, and is there basically anything over here which will tell you that SRC and destination? Give the destination, tell what is the source and what is the destination, and then you can create a symlink. You can tell you want to copy the file, and there are many other things which you can do with this. But this is good, but we'll be using it with templates so that it will become stronger. Okay, so generally we don't copy static files. We will always copy a files which will have some dynamic nature into it. So I'll be combining this stuff with something called as templates at a later point of time. But with all stuff, if you just want to create a file, you can still use this. So for example, if I want to create a file, okay, I can write something like hyphen name, okay, create file, and then the module name is file, okay, path, whatever path which you want it to be. So var www html info.php. Okay, and state is done. So this will create a file. Okay, so let us assume that this file is present at some location and you want to copy it. Then you will, rather than using path, you will be using something called as source and destination, and then state is file. So it will copy that file from some other location to this location, all of that. Okay, but this file I'll be covering at a later point of time, because we will be doing deployment, and whenever you are doing deployment, you need to copy a huge file than this. So I want to use that in that context. So as of now, I'm skipping this area. Okay, good. So anything which you want to do, there will mostly be a module. There will mostly be a module for all the basic Linux commands. You will always find a module. Okay, I will come back to the step. If you don't find a module, what can be done? If you don't find a module, what has to be done? That is, let us take it at a later point of time. But for now, let us try to execute the work, whatever we have done. Okay, so let me go to the AWS. The today's Ansible file which we have written can be improved a lot. Okay, so this is our first file. So I'm using this, but probably in the next couple of classes, if I have to use the same LAMP stack stuff, we'll be writing a better playbook, because we still have to learn some of the topics. We are just applying the modules into our script and we are following it sequentially. Okay, your better script is when you don't hard code variables. Okay, then you put any variables directly PL Russian. I've used Apache 2. I've used all of that stuff. I want to get rid of that stuff. That's the first thing. And the next thing is, I don't want to copy and paste any task couple of times. For example, service task, I've copied it couple of times. That is not a best practice, right? So these are the two things which can be improved. One is hard coding the stuff. Why do I have to use a name over here, which is something like Apache 2? Today I want to install Apache 2. Tomorrow, if Apache 2 gets renamed to Apache 3, then will my script work? No. So how to get rid of those kind of things? And why do I need to write different script for Red Hat and different script for Ubuntu? Why not everything in the same file? So that's where we need to go in. Okay. But today this is a very, very, very trivial or very simple way of looking at it. Okay, but we will slowly get into the complications of it, right? Okay. So let me get into the Ansible control server. Any place is okay, because we have username and password, right? So SSH, Ansible, @ Okay, we are good. And then so let me copy that YAML file. I can use SCP also, but it's okay. Let me copy and paste it. So vi lamp dot oem. Okay, I'll be copying whatever is here. Okay, good. Okay, now shall I execute this? Ansible hyphen playbook and then lamp dot. So this will be executed on how many machines? Two machines, because I in my inventory currently I have two entries. One is Ansible control server, the other one is the node. So for which this should work on both the machines. Okay. Was it really difficult to do this? Right. So please use. I have done only LAMP. So I want you to do in Nginx also today. Try LAMP, Nginx, all right? And what is the other thing which you can give it a try is, you can try Tomcat. You can try Tomcat. So try these three things and try to write a YAML file for that. Okay? If you want to understand what it is doing, also use -vvv. Very detailed elaboration of what Ansible is doing with respect to Linux commands also will come into play, right? Now, if I have done everything good, let me go to this. And this is my address, right? So let me go with this. Is this working? No. Okay. Now let me see the status. Just so sudo service Apache 2. What it is saying? It is running. And if it is running, it should be accessible. If you are in this state, the only thing that can stop is the firewall on Ansible, on AWS. Okay. So just go to here. scroll to the extreme left, and then you are seeing a security group called as Ansible. Okay, so we are trying to access http://, which is a HTTP protocol, and generally HTTP protocol is on port 80. Okay, so let me go to the inbound over here, edit, and add a rule saying that I am interested in opening HTTP port to everyone. Save this. Did you got the page? So any port which you have, whenever you think that it is not working, please go and do that. Okay, because sometimes security group might be blocking it. In this case, it was not problem with Ansible, it was problem with security group. We have just opened it and we are accessing this stuff. Good. Yes. Okay. And now connection lost and also not audible. Host node 1, node 2. We are not discussing that right now. We'll be parking that discussion for tomorrow. Right? Okay. So guys, am I audible or not? Yes. Okay. So only for one person my audio is lost. That might be a problem with. Yeah. Okay. Wonderful. So looking good. Yeah. So what were the steps? What are the steps which I have followed? I first find out the installation document. I've copied all the individual Linux commands. And for every Linux command, I've converted that into a task. And for converting that into a task, I have taken the help of something called as module. And in the module, I have told what is the state which I am interested in. What we'll be doing is we'll be complicating this journey with tomorrow, trying to basically make out certain stuffs where you generally don't have a module for that. So in that case, how do you do that? If you don't have a module, how to do that? And then one more question is, I am always doing hosts all. That doesn't sound like an approach. So what we'll be discussing tomorrow is, we'll be discussing tomorrow on the inventory file. And how to basically create or do something with the inventory file. Okay, good. Now, as promised, one more machine to our Ansible control server. Yes, shall I configure it? Yeah, we know the steps. Yeah, okay. So let me go ahead and create one more machine. Okay, so let me take CentOS. Okay, are you seeing CentOS? And there is FreeTier eligible also. Select this. I'm adding one more node 2. We have only two machines right now, Ansible control server and node 1. Now I want to add node 2. Next. Node. And if you remember, node 2 is not Ubuntu, node 2 is going to be CentOS. And I will be using the same security group, which is Ansible, whatever I've basically used. Launch. I'll be using a pair, which is Ansible. Okay, let us quickly try to configure this, whatever is possible till whatever time which we have, right? So what are the steps you need to tell me? I need to create a user called as Ansible, and then add that user to the sudoers group, and then since it is AWS machine, password based authentication is disabled, so I need to enable password based authentication. And once I do all of that, I need to install Python. And once I install the Python, okay, then I'll go to my Ansible control server and copy my public key to this machine using SSH copy ID, right? This is the steps. So connect. Let me go over here, and my PEM file is generally in the downloads. So I'm going over here. I'm doing this. You should become comfortable with this. That's why I'm trying it. This is probably the third time which I'm doing this, right? Yeah. So root is not the right user. It will tell you what is the username which you have to use. So what is it trying to tell? The username is CentOS. So now change this from root to CentOS. Okay, I'm in. Now let me become a root user. Sudo -i. Then add user Ansible. Okay. Here you will not have all of the privileges. PASSWD Ansible. Change the password for Ansible. I know it is bad, but it's okay. Because for me, username and password is the same. Okay, good. Now, what is the other thing which you need to do? We need to add this user to the sudoers group. How do I do that? VI. Okay. So come down over here. This will be slightly different because of this is Red Hat, right? Okay. Sorry, Singh. We'll be following something like this. Why to write? Rather than this wheel, what is our user's name? Done? Okay. Good. Now, shall I log in into the other machine and log in into this user and see whether this user has that permissions or not? So exit su Ansible. Okay, I've typed it wrongly. Done. Now, if I have permissions, I should be able to execute sudo commands without any problem. So sudo. I'll not do yum update because it will take hell lot of time. So let me do yum install git minus y. Working, and it has not asked me for password also. So we are in right step. The next thing which we have to do is we have to enable password based authentication into this machine. Okay, so for that, sudo, I'll be acting as a CentOS user only, and I'll be trying to do vi etc ssh / sshd underscore config. And in there, we'll have something called as password authentication. Yes, password authentication, no, comment it out by adding hash to it or delete that line using dd. Okay, done. And then I need to restart sshd. So service, so sudo service sshd. Good. And now let me see if I have Python in this machine. Python hyphen hyphen. I already have Python. So there is no need for me to worry about it. Okay. Everything is done. There is one more thing which you have to do on CentOS machine that let us worry at later point of time. Okay. Now, I'll be going into my control server. Yeah. And now, from my control server, if I have to configure this machine, will I use public IP or private IP? Private. Let me use the private DNS name. All right. So what is it? SSH copy ID Ansible @ yes. Done. And if this is successful, what should happen? If I do SSH, okay, and then just the machine's name, it should log in. Is it logging in? Yes. Okay, so Let me exit out. What is one more test which we have to do? Ping test. So to do the ping test, I need to add it to the inventory file, right? So sudo vi etc ansible and host file, and let me add one more entry to it, which is the CentOS machine, and then ansible minus m ping all. Working? Yes. So did we configure CentOS machine also? Yeah, that's it. Steps, did they change largely? On any Linux machine, you would have the same steps. Okay. First day, while we were configuring, it has taken a lot of time. Okay. Second day, it was less. But what is the time which it has taken today? Approximately 3 to 4 minutes. Okay. Is there any confusion in this configuration? Okay. Be very clear about this configuration. This is very, very easy if you do it. So daily add one server and remove one stuff. If you don't want to add extra cost, add one more server. Okay. Add it to your node list and do this activity again and again, so that you will not have much of problems, right? So is it clear? Yes. So now we have one Ubuntu machine and one CentOS machine, and now the problems will start. Now if I run the script, okay, now if I do this, what will happen? It will work on two machines. On one machine it will fail because it will don't know what an apt is, right? Did you remember our lamp stuff? Lamp was specifically written for Ubuntu machines, but I have CentOS machine. Now if I try to execute this, what would happen is it will fail saying that I don't know what an apt is, because apt is meant to be run only on Ubuntu machines, but you are trying to run it on CentOS machine, it will fail. So that's how the complexity is add on. Now how do I basically ensure that it doesn't work on, or the script whatever I've written works only on Ubuntu, not on CentOS machines? So how do I do that? So we will be discussing about these aspects, where we'll be learning about something called as facts. We'll be learning about something called as facts. So let us do that discussion in the subsequent classes. All right? Is it clear? Okay. So let me stop it at that. Yeah. While we push configuration to Windows servers also through, yes, you can do that. You can do that. But the only difference is the protocol changes there. It is not SSH, it is WinRM. Okay. How to dynamically CSN? I have an interview with ADP, and as discussed with HR first round, I just wanted to know about how this test is being. Call to Satish's number. Anyway, I'm going to tea. I have 5 to 10 minutes of time. I'll try to tell. Call to Satish immediately. I'll pick up the phone. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'm becoming not reachable, man. Much like Jio signal. Yes. Yeah. Fine. Thanks. We'll meet in tomorrow's class. And remember, tomorrow's class will be in short time. We'll not have a elaborate class. Monday, we had a smaller session, right? Next Monday and next Thursday also, I'll have a smaller session because I have some series of trainings at office, which I have to present, and I have to be on time, right? So please bear with me on that, right? Thanks. So much. Can you? What is your question? How will we run the YAML file if we have web? We'll be worrying about that in the next class, Seshi. And so much. I think please type your question in the tomorrow's class. I'll try to answer with that. I'll try to start tomorrow's class with your question. Yeah. Okay.